Hello and welcome to the St. Louis Art Museum's Art Speaks program. My name is Jessica Kennedy and I'm the educator for adult learning at the museum. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. To get us started and to introduce today's speaker, I will pass the virtual microphone to Alexander Marr, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation Assistant Curator of Native American Art. Thanks, Alex.
Thank you, Jessica. The St. Louis region is the ancestral territory for a lineage of Native American peoples, including the Mississippian civilization that built Cahokia and mounds in St. Louis in the early in the last millennium. In the 18th and 19th centuries, colonial settlement disrupted subsequent indigenous relations with this place. The Osage Nation and members of the Illini Confederacy, including the Peoria Tribe of Oklahoma, know the St. Louis region as part of their homelands. Finally, I want to recognize the diversity of Native peoples who live and work in St. Louis today. I'm thrilled to welcome Cory Willmott to the virtual stage. The talk that we'll hear today is presented in association with the exhibition Woodlands, Native American Art from St. Louis Collections at the St. Louis Art Museum. The exhibition opened last Friday, October 29th, and remains on view through April 24th, 2022, in the McDonald Gallery on the first floor of the museum. The exhibition presents art from the Woodlands, a vast region that encompasses the Great Lakes, Atlantic Coast, and southeastern United States. The exhibition assembles rarely seen works from local private collections, neighboring institutions, and the museum's own holdings. For the first time, the museum surveys historic and modern textile, sculpture, and graphic art by Indigenous artists from Eastern North America. Dr. Willmott is a leading scholar of Great Lakes textiles. She has published widely on historical Great Lakes dress in journals including Textile History, American Indian Art Magazine, and History and Anthropology. Her current research project examines the strap dress, a little studied style of women's clothing from the fur trade era. Dr. Willmott is also active in digital humanities, contributing, for instance, to the formation of GRASAC, the online Great Lakes Research Alliance for the Study of Aboriginal Arts and Cultures. She holds a PhD from McMaster University in anthropology and a master's in interdisciplinary studies from York University. She is the recipient of research fellowships at the University of Winnipeg and grants to study museum collections around the world. Previously, Dr. Willmott taught at the University of Manitoba. Now she calls the St. Louis region home as professor of anthropology at Southern Illinois University, Edwardsville. Cory, thank you so much for sharing your experience. Your expertise today.
Thank you so much, Alex, and thank you, Jessica, as well for introducing me. I'm really thrilled to be giving this talk because this topic really was the topic that sparked my interest in Great Lakes art in the first place. Back in the late 1980s. And much of what I've been studying for this talk has brought that interest full circle through a wide range of experiences and peoples. I will be in this presentation talking about the spiritual heritage of Great Lakes nations, particularly the Anishinaabe and Potawatomi, Odawa, Menominee, members of the Three Fires Confederacy. And so I want to just give a teeny weeny little shout out to the artists and bead workers and elders with whom I spent hours, weeks, years in beadworking circles in the Toronto and Southern Ontario community, as well as my colleagues at GRASAC, with whom I studied in museum collections hours and weeks. And I've been very privileged and grateful for those opportunities. There's so much to say about this topic of cosmic geometry in Anishinaabe textiles and the Woodlands collection at SLAM, the St. Louis Art Museum, is so rich in having these textiles that there's really way too much to say to keep within your lunch hour. So within the interest of keeping it in time, I am going to read a little more formally a paper that I prepared, but I hope that you will think of questions along the way that you can share with me and we can have a conversation at the end of my more formal presentation. To introduce us to some cosmological principles in Anishinaabe worldview, this beautiful hand drum in the SLAM exhibit can show us several things, the most important of which is going to be the three-tiered cosmology, the lower world, which you can see below this line, which is the middle world. So the lower world, middle world, and upper world. On the back side of the drum, celestial symbols of moon, sun, and stars. And the larger side of the three-tiered universe, the upper world, on the drum face, show us the significance of the upper world among the three. Now, I'm not saying that one world is more significant than the other, but in this particular context, the singer, the owner of the drum, who is probably a healer, these hand drums were used in healing ceremonies, is calling upon the spiritual power of the thunderbird. The birds on the drum, the one on the left is an eagle. We can identify it as an eagle because of its downturning head and beak, as well as its up pointing wings and the ruffled feathers on its legs. It actually looks a lot like the kind of form that a member of the eagle totem or clan would draw his or her membership. And the one on the right is drawn in the conventional form of a thunderbird, and particularly a female thunderbird, and both eagle and thunderbird are singing. When we look at other drums of this nature, we see a lot of similarities. Both of these drums have the dividing line between the three worlds, again emphasizing the three-tiered universe, as well as the thunderbirds in the upper realm. I'd also like to point out the color symbolism here is predominantly blue and red. In fact, this drum has three faded blue thunderbirds here, as well as a blue line here. Blue and red, predominant colors. And getting back to our drum in the SLAM exhibit, the one on the right is an 1840 drum that has the most similar symbolism, but again, rendered in more of the blue and red, or black in this case, and red symbolism. And then the one on the left has the yellow and blue predominant emphasis. So how does this color symbolize the cosmos? Many of you may already know that red, blue or black, yellow and white are the colors of the four sacred directions, which are the surface of the earth that intersects the vertical three-tiered universe. Okay, so there's the four sacred colors. And sometimes the artist is not going to use all these colors. Sometimes the artist will, in fact, substitute colors for other colors. I suspect that this may be the case with the SLAM drum. We can see that there's actually not just yellow, but there's yellow and orange, the orange at the bottom row of the horizontal line on the thunderbird, on the trimmings of the eagle, and also in the singing, may in fact stand in for red. And this would align it more with the color symbolism more typical of that three-tiered universe or cosmos. Now, to get into textiles, this very same three-tiered universe will be represented on just about every kind of medium imaginable in Great Lakes textiles. Here we have this wonderful pair of leggings, men's leggings, in the Missouri History Museum collection. It is in the exhibit at SLAM as well. It's a very typical kind of design, showing a contrasting dark and red, like a dark blue. That is actually blue, although it looks black in the picture. It's standing in for black symbolically, black and red, then with the opposing women thunderbirds facing each other in the opposite colors. And this kind of play of back and forth is emphasizing the movement, the fluidity between the upper and lower worlds. Let's not ignore the middle world, because the shape of the leggings is that of deer legs. The dew claws of the deer are represented in those points. And also, it's not just that there's black and red, and red and white. There's also red on this trim and blue that has faded on the outside of the red. So in very simple terms, these leggings reinforce not only the three-tiered cosmology, but also the relation between and among them as being fluid and interplaying all the time on each other, and then back and forth and up and down and so on. So that is done as an applique stitch, and you can make any kind of representational form that you want with applique stitch. But most of the textiles we're going to be talking about are woven. And when with weaving, because there's a grid formation, it pushes us more towards geometry. There are three types of weaving represented in the exhibit: finger weaving, heddle weaving, and loom weaving. This finger weaving is, as the name suggests, done without a loom. Heddle weaving is done with a heddle. This is a heddle, and it's usually done on a backstrap loom. In other words, it's attached at one end to a pole or a tree, and at the other end, the weaver holds it in their lap. And then in contrast, the loom weaving is done right on the loom, where the warp threads are strung right on the loom. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute here. Twine bags are finger woven bags that are made on a circular pattern wrapped around two poles, as shown in this little illustration here. That's twining, means going around like that. So they're done in a circle, and there's no loom per se. They're finger woven, but they're made on this pair of poles. They provide the key to understanding the nuts and bolts, or basics, like the basic principles of the geometric symbolism in Anishinaabe textiles. It was in 1989, Ruth B. Phillips wrote a seminal article in which she posited that the Thunderbird images on the one side of the bag and the Mishapeshu or underwater panther images on the other side of the bag, enclosed and made out of fibers from the earth, enclosed a sacred area that represented a total cosmos. In addition, she looked at a series of bags and suggested that those representations of these powerful cosmic beings toward the end of the 19th century, had transformed into abstracted geometry. Okay, so we'll take a look at that in a second here. I want to mention that I feel comfortable talking about Mishapeshu and Thunderbird today because it did go below freezing in St. Louis today. And there is a tradition of not telling and not talking about these powerful beings during the summer months, particularly Mishapeshu being such a powerful being that's not always on the side of the Anishinaabe or the people in the middle world. But having frozen, we can speak freely of them in the winter months. I am working on a project that's not really quite finished, where I have a comparative collection of over 30 twined bags that I'm looking at. And in them, I've broken down the elements of the just geometric forms, basic geometric forms, and where they appear on the bags, how frequently they appear on the bags, and in what relations they appear on the bags. And so this is a sort of a preliminary look at the basic units and how they map to the upper world, middle world, and lower world. So I can't say for certain because the study is not complete, but this is the hypothesis. We'll just keep these shapes in mind as we look at some more bags. This bag, which is actually early 19th century, is earlier than the previous one. So we can't say that evolution is moving in a strictly linear temporal time, frame from early to middle to late or whatever, because it is not. They're not all the bags that are this way or that way or at this time or that time. But we can see in this one that there is still the same basic frame with the vertical lines with a central panel within, but this time the central panel within is not the fully represented Thunderbird, but rather the zigzag lines representing lightning that come from the eyes of the Thunderbird, and on the reverse, a concentric hexagon representing the whirlpool made by Mishapeshu's extra long tail. And these geometric references are also found in Anishinaabe narratives, where you would refer obliquely to a Thunderbird or a Mishapeshu by the lightning or the whirlpool. The idea of representing powerful beings in geometric form was developing in multiple media. And I'm hypothesizing that the change to this horizontal row orientation that happened after mid-19th century may have been influenced or borrowed from other kinds of textiles, such as garters. Garters were worn under the knee to keep the leggings in place. This example of men's garters from 1930s to 1950s-ish, or sorry, 30s to, through 40s-ish. I could probably speak for the whole talk about those leggings, but I won't. Here, I'm just looking at this, these patterns of diamonds with triangles and diamonds and triangles as well down here. Really very similar to where we see in this late 19th century bag and late 19th century style of bag, this middle section of diamond mesh with hand-holding thunderbirds above and below, and the checkerboards in between. We can read this now as the lower world with the middle world and upper worlds, the symmetrical line being here, going the other way, this way, up and down, the same, the movement between the worlds. With this type of bag, now once we've oriented to horizontal, because all three worlds are represented on the one side, most of these bags have the same pattern on both sides. And remember that the weaver is working around in a circle. Not so with this extraordinary, wonderful bag in the SLAM exhibit, because this one has the horizontal orientation, but it has both sides different. And it's really interesting pattern. This is the side that's visible in the exhibit right now. And we can clearly see this row of diamonds again, representing the underworld, and possibly more specifically representing a quote, medicine man's eye, in the words of one Midwayan initiate who told this to Sister Bernard Coleman in the 40s. And then we have, you know, so this we're reading as the underworld or the lower world, sorry, surrounded by two panels of the upper world, as we saw in the previous bag we're looking at. On the other side, we have those orientations reversed. So in the middle, we have these series of parallelograms, banded parallelograms or a parallelogram mesh, which we can read for a variation of a Thunderbird motif. And then we have these very complex chevrons and diamonds within diamonds, chevrons, diamonds in a figure ground play. And the figure ground play is very characteristic of these Anishinaabe cosmic textiles. Here, though, the diamonds, the same diamond within a diamond is the one we saw over here. And the chevrons, if I went back to the original slide where I showed that twine bag with the Mishipeshu on it, the chevrons appear often in the body of Mishipeshu. So we can read this as a reverse of this. And that's not always as obvious with these kinds of bags, but this one is now, once we're developing this lexicon, just shouting out to me that we've got reverse sides, where here we have upper, lower, upper, here we have lower, upper, lower. Just absolutely fabulous bag. The same complex chevron diamond motif appears in a wonderful pair of Hedla woven garters that is actually in the SLAM collection. It has been attributed to the Ho-Chunk. I'm not sure exactly why, but it may be Ho-Chunk, but it is also a pattern that Anishinaabe use a lot. Here is an example of Little Cloud, an Ojibwe chief who visited Washington in somewhere between 1870 and 1895. And Charles Bell photographed him, and he's wearing garters here that have this same motif. And this is Louis Corbine, who wore a belt with this motif to the Milwaukee Summer Festival in 1936. So we can see that across regional nations, as well as across time and through multiple media, this design has a very salient significance. Now, what about this heddle weaving? How is it done with a heddle? it's kind of tricky to explain, but I'll do my best. So the weaver would string the warp threads through alternating holes and slats across. Actually, first the slats are strung, and then with two threads, and then one of each pair is strung back through the hole. Why do we do this? Because those threads that are in the hole are going to remain in place. But as you move the heddle up and down, you create a hole through which you're going to shoot your shuttle. And then when you do your next row, you have reversed it and the shuttle will be thrown through again. And that reverse and reverse keeps the weaving in place. Now, if you have beads on there, you have to thread the beads on the weft first. So believe me, I've not tried this, but I have done a lot of loom weaving, and I can tell you this is going to be very, very difficult, especially when you think about counting out the colors of those beads and getting them on the weft first and so on. Very, very complex. Also, you can see from these two examples, one of them Potawatomi, the other Anishinaabe, that the petals themselves were beautiful, remarkable works of art and would have been one of the prized possessions of any woman who was using it and who owned it. Here's a close-up view of if you're looking at a piece of loom woven beadwork, how do you tell if it's heddle woven? So on the left, we can see that because the weft thread only goes through the bead once on the heddle weaving. It only goes through that once. It's thread on in advance, and then it is the crossing of the warp threads that keeps those beads in place. And you can see those turns here in between, and you can see just a lot more thread here. In comparison with this loom weaving, the threads are thread before passing through, but they're thread on a needle. And then what you can do is you pass the needle back through the row of threads, keeping your needle above the warp thread. So the warp thread, the weft thread, I should say, goes below the warp thread on the way through the first time and above the warp thread on the way through the second time. That's what keeps the beads in place. And the resulting textile has much less threads actually showing. Well, now we come to the what I call the superstar bandolier bag of the exhibit. This bag is a superstar for a variety of reasons, one of which is that it is heddle woven. Seeing it in person, it's a little smaller than most bandolier bags, so it may be a child's bandolier bag. Nonetheless, for a piece of heddle weaving, it's easily twice as wide as anything I've ever seen before. So in the middle here is a heddle that is 84 warp threads wide. 84, that's the widest one I've seen in any museum collection. This is easily double that. So the number of beads and threaded on the warp threads across that middle pouch area is just extraordinary to think of counting out those beads to make that pattern, and just even manually handling the piece as you're working with it. It's just extraordinary artwork. And technical virtuosity involved in making this pouch, making the whole bag for that matter. Another example here, this was originally, I think, attributed to the Menominee. I'm sure Alex knows this better than I don't remember the original attribution, but my point here is that it's often been thought that Anishinaabe Ojibwe proper did not use these kind of smaller repeating patterns because their classic pattern, as I'll show at the end, is the exploding X pattern, which is short form geometric for Thunderbird, okay? But there are many instances where Anishinaabe people did use these kind of repeating patterns. Here's an example of an Anishinaabe woman wearing a pair of bandolier bags, one of which has a honeycomb pattern, another has a star like pattern on it in both cases, smaller repeating patterns. So it's very hard to say this is this attribution, this is that attribution, but we can be inclusive and say it could have been a Menominee, Ho-Chunk, Potawatomi, it could have been Ojibwe, all very closely related Great Lakes, Woodlands peoples. This bag in the middle of the slide is a bag at the Missouri History Museum that has a very similar motif to the one on the SLAM heddle woven bag. The one at MHM is loom woven. But in looking at the patterns, they've been very puzzling to me for a great many years. And in doing this presentation, I had a sort of a breakthrough when I read an article by Alan Corbier about the symbolism on wampum belts. Of course, wampum was woven, also kind of a form of loom weaving. And so it's not surprising to find wampum patterns on bandolier bags, but I don't recall anyone ever really mentioning it to me before or even having that conversation during one of our GRASAC museum study collection conversations. Okay, I might not be the first person to say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. So thanks to Alan for that insight. The squares and the diamonds on these two wampum belts are referring to particular nations, and the lines, one that goes all the way through the middle of the bottom one and other little corners of the top one represent paths. And so the implication of both of these paths or both of these belts are that the nations are walking together in peace. I'm sure Alan could elaborate this better than I am right now. But my point is in relation to these bandolier patterns that have repeating patterns of alternating diamonds and squares like this one, diamonds and squares in the middle of this one, diamonds and squares. I think we can relate this, and here even is bordered with squares with the line going through, just like if we combine these two wampum belts, we would see this same pattern. So what's going on here, I think, in a very broad sense, I think we can relate these patterns of smaller motifs in rows, in row form, to the medicine wheel, Bimadaswin, living the good life. And in a more specific sense, teachings I learned in Minnesota, and I can't say that they are universal to all Anishinaabe areas, are that the cross indicates the pulse in a Midwayan initiation, and the squares would indicate the mats or the blankets where gifts were given. In fact, the idea of the blanket or the mat is also part of the lexicon of the wampum belts. And so we could also read these paths as walking through the lodge in a Midwayan ceremony. Now, I'm not qualified to speak most specifically about Midwayan ceremonies. I will leave that to experts who are Anishinaabe and who are members of Midwayan. But I think it's important for people to understand the deeper meanings of these geometric patterns. They're not just geometric patterns by any stretch of the imagination. They really refer very specifically to cosmology and concepts of relationships among humans and other than human beings, and relationships that are built and reinforced among and between humans and other than human beings. And the geometry should not fool us into thinking that they have no meaning. Another aspect of this bandolier bag that makes it a superstar is how explicit it refers to this little heart or berry. In bandolier bags in general, this area between the main central pouch and the straps is significant and always treated differently than other design regions of the band, of the bag. In this one, this tiny little heart descends from this motif, which is a half otter tail or otter trail, and then these zigzags. Otter tail, I want to say, if you look at it as diamonds and then extended diamonds, it's really alternating symbols of the underworld, and then of course, or the lower world, sorry. And of course, the zigzags are representing the lightning. So we have here enclosed in this little rectangular area, also a path. So really all of this is, you know, all three worlds represented again. And in the middle, we have the heart. Now, heart berry, Odomen, it could be a strawberry, it could be a heart. In Ojibwe language, Odomen means strawberry. So really that those two concepts are very closely related. But what it speaks to me is the idea of a very old shamanic principle of the heart line represented in the skeletal form and sort of seeing through the being into the inner being. So what this is shouting out to me is that the bag is animate, is the bag itself is an other than human person. To which we can relate. And we can see this. We can see this in other kind of form as Anishinaabe art starts to explode into elaborating geometrics and eventually into floral work. But now that you have been introduced to these little geometric basics, we can see this going on almost everywhere. It's amazing. So here with these darling pair of dolls, we have the zigzags here and the path here. And then on this pair of crossing bandoliers, we have the otter trail on one side and the lightning on the other. Here we have a similar sort of thing with the diamonds here and the hexagons here. And here's the exploding X that I was speaking of. And again here, now this has been elaborated, but still there is that central figure that possibly represents the heart of the bandolier bag itself. And it may not be universal everywhere, but the Anishinaabe term for bandolier bag is also an animate name. So we'll just keep that in mind. I'm not too sure how meaningful that is, but it is the fact. And here now, as we move into the early 20th century, late 19th century, the just exuberant, wonderful floral beadwork that the Anishinaabe are best well known for just explodes upon the scene. And this set of regalia, men's regalia with that floral beadwork is one of the most beautiful pieces in the exhibit. Now, I really could go on and on and on this topic, and I really have many more thoughts about it, but I'd love to hear your thoughts. I'd love to open it up to conversation and take any questions that you might have.
Great. Thank you, Cory. We do actually have one question. So if anyone else is interested, please type up your questions now. So the one that we have here is, do you feel that the abstraction of these concepts into geometry was done in response to colonialism or as an independent evolution?
Great question. And one that has been tossed around. And I've seen that thesis, that it was a response to colonialism. And the same thesis has been presented with regard to the shift to floral beadwork. And I actually think it's more probable with regard to the floral beadwork. Because you see with the floral beadwork that we're even departing from this basic grid pattern, you know, the grid is so important to the whole cosmology. And cosmology is the link to place. And the idea of being always in the center of that four directions and that three-tiered universe, I mean, it's just so central to being in the world as an Anishinaabe person, that I honestly feel that there may have been some influence in that direction, but I really feel it was a more of a generic move. It was already happening in the early 1800s, and we see it in multiple forms. At that point, Anishinaabe were not on reservations. They were not, they were still practicing their traditional life ways. So I feel that these geometrics are really, really fundamental, really fundamental. And maybe they changed form a little bit in response to colonialism, but I don't think it has the same kind of colonial stamp to it as does the shift to florals. And just to finish that off, I don't want to say anything bad about the florals, which are absolutely fantastic and also have deep, deep meaning that we're not addressing in this presentation. That would be a whole other topic. But I really feel these geometrics are fundamental and nothing is lost in the shift.
Yeah.
Okay. Except maybe our understanding of them.
Thank you. All right, so we have quite a few that have popped up here, which is great. Let's see. Someone asked if you might re-explain the symbolism of the crosses on the works. You've mentioned them in several of them, and wonder if you might be able to just kind of re-say again what that symbolism is.
Sure. I'm going to try to get back to one here. So they appear here and also here. They're not as obvious here. Here they're quite obvious, and here as well. In the most fundamental way, equidistant cross, and I should have said this, so thank you for asking, represents the four sacred directions. And we see this on all kinds of media, even back to rock art. You know, so it's just, you know, a very, very basic symbol. Later, maybe it gets specifically linked to what I mentioned of the pulse in the midway when Lodge, but really how we should understand that cross is as the four sacred directions, or the four sacred persons, as they might also be called.
Yeah, great, thank you. Someone else has asked, are there certain patterns or geometric shapes that are associated with certain families or spiritual leaders within the tribe or tribes?
I love that question. Some of you might know that I've spent several decades also studying the Anishinaabe dodemic emblems, which do represent families. And I'm reading that eagle on the drum as a dodem, that the dodem of the drummer in relating to the Thunderbirds. I have never seen a dodemic emblem that was not representational. I've also never seen So there's some documentation, interesting documentation of Anishinaabe naming practices changing to have individual representations of individuals' names because of multi-dotum villages, then you have to distinguish more specifically names. At that point, some geometric shapes do enter into the lexicon. But as far as the families and dotums themselves, I have never seen that. It's always an animal or fish or bird, or even sometimes a birch bark or other kinds of flora.
Thank you. Someone else has asked, what is the representation of the exploding X?
What about it? Do we want to elaborate more?
Yeah, just what does it, represent something? Or is there, just talk a little more about it.
Sure.
Thanks.
So there have been several publications, and most recently, Marcia Anderson's very thorough book on bandolier bags. And so this is something we know more about than most things, because there have been, you know, just fascination with these bags for decades. And the thing about the exploding X being the earlier bags are loom woven and they are geometric in nature. Later they switch, and we see that sort of movement towards floral on this one here, where the exploding X has sort of divided into two motifs that look, could even be read as leaves, for example. But that classic exploding X, as I quickly jumped over, is probably an hourglass shape that is, even if we went all the way back to the beginning of this talk about bags, to this bag, we can see the hourglass shape of the Thunderbird. So that shape, and I wish I could think of a more appropriate non-colonial way to discuss it, because hourglass is just so awfully colonial, limited little time that's going to end after the sand drops to the bottom of the glass. But anyway, I hate that metaphor, but I can't think of another way to describe it, really. I guess triangles that are inverted facing each other, something like that. But, you know, that's complicated. But it's really very clearly a reference to the Thunderbird. And so the bags, when we see them developing with that exploding X, even though it's elaborated with all these other designs swirling around and so on, that X is just so prominent, shouting out Thunderbird.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Thank you. Okay, I think this is going to be our last question. Someone has asked, are there examples of Anishinaabe art from before 17th century, or have they been destroyed?
Well, textiles don't hold up very well.
Yeah.
So Anishinaabe art in general, absolutely, in some sturdier medium, have certainly survived. And that would, I would not necessarily be an expert on that. Much of that is archaeological material that has been excavated, but also there was, in the early colonial period, Europeans who were collecting Anishinaabe art were not staying here. So they took much of it to Europe. So the earliest pieces, most of the earliest Anishinaabe art is in European collections. And so I am among fortunate people who have been able to visit some of those European collections. But before 1700, specifically 1600s, you know, even with textiles, really, I can't think of anything. I can think of one 1600s belt that's not Anishinaabe, but it's Wampanoag, I think, East Coast. So that's a very complicated question. And I'd say short answer, yes. Long answer, very complicated, dispersed, hard to find. Yeah. Different people know about it, archaeologists and so on.
Yeah, and that makes sense about textiles specifically. Those are harder to keep. Well, thank you. That is going to be our last question. Thank you so much, Cory. This has been absolutely fascinating. And I hope that everyone is able to come and see the exhibition. So now that they have all of this background knowledge, they're able to come and enjoy it in an even new and different way. And I just want to thank everyone for joining us today. If you'd like, register to join us next Thursday, November 11th at noon, to hear curator Amy Torbert explore works of art included in the last thematic section titled Art as Advocate, which is in the exhibition Art Along the Rivers, a Bicentennial Celebration. So that is going to be the last talk in a series of talks that we've had with another exhibition that we have up. So I encourage you to register for that program and more at slam.org/events. And thanks again, Cory, and I hope everyone has a great day.
Thank you.